Okay, do you remember where you were in the story?
Oh yeah, like I said, I took a Persetti out for him in a, on a gun placement out there in the middle of the field. He didn't particularly care for that one bit after about 2 days of it. Well, he was sure glad to get back in that half track, and I asked him, I said, do you think it'll work? He said, I'll take care of it from now on. Well, he did not like going there. But yeah, we had a pretty good half track.
Did you tell me before that the actual almost hand-to-hand combat or house-to-house?
Well, that was another one.
Was that where you've been yet, or we haven't gotten it yet?
No, that was the first one. Yeah, you know, really and truly, you talk about things like that happen. One day is a book. I mean, you don't have to rattle on what did you do in 3 weeks or 4 weeks or a week. One day. In the life of some of those boys over there, it's a complete history. It's a book, you know. The things that happened from morning to night that was over with, you know. And that's the way it went.
Do you have a vision of what would be the most scary, frightening day? Or the most combat, let's say?
No, not really.
How close were you in your closest... did you ever have actual eyeball contact with somebody that determined they had to shoot?
Yeah. We took a town one time, we were coming in from the outside of town, and if it wasn't for Benner, I think I'd be dead. We came into town, we were clearing the houses, shooting through the houses, going through. I came, just as I got by this house, I got my rifle, and I'm holding it like this, and I walked right past the house without looking. Probably a foot and a half, about a foot inside the walkway. Again, the house ends right here. When I looked over at that German standing right back there about 25 feet away, he's got his rifle on his shoulder, and he's looking right at me. And I, at that moment, if God is my creator, I knew I'm going to die. I know he's going to shoot me. By the grace of God, Benner, he's my cover. On this side, he looks this way. I watched that. That's why I didn't pay any attention. I'm trying to cover Benner with somebody up on him. He, you know, we look, when we run through a town, usually on the street, I'll cover to the right because I can see the whole right. Benner covers to my left, but he can see the left as we go down, you know. Mm-hmm. He walked out. That crowd saw Benner. He put his rifle down, put his hand on his head, and walked out. If he hadn't seen Benner, he'd have shot me, so I know he would have shot me. I know it. And a few minutes after that, we're clearing the houses, and I didn't see Chester Tank. And Tank comes in the back of the house. And somehow or another,
what's a Chester Tank?
He didn't want another gunner.
Oh, yeah, that's the name of somebody.
We clear a house sometime, we would have machine guns, and we just take a rifle, grenade, and take house after house, and that's the way we have to do it. If there's a German in the house, we gotta find him, get him the hell out of there. If there isn't, okay, we're locked down. I can't take him. Chester came to the front door. No, he was in the middle. He was in the middle of the house. He came in the back door. I was already in the house. I was in the front room. There's a stairwell. It's right straight upstairs. And he rattles the doorknob. I don't know whether it was Mike. I don't know if Mike was with me. Mike usually was with me. Someone shot through the door, shot him right in the stomach. But he had a big belt buckle. I mean, this is one of these things you read about. The funny thing that happened, hit right in the buckle. But he had a carbine. If he had a 30 or 6, it would have went right through him. You know, where he cleared the house, he had a little carbine which had 14 shots in it. You could shoot pretty good around here. I usually have an old 6 with an AP in it. Because when I cleared a house, I went through the wall, I went right through the wall. I mean, I probably won't kill that German because it would be a nice little hole and go through him too. But at least if I don't see somebody in there, I'm just shooting right through the wall. The hell is, you know, I don't have to look around the door then. You know. But anyway, I shot Chester. He stood there, his eyes that big, grilled in the door. Whew, knocked him flat, you know, knocked him right back in the head. Everything turned out okay then.
Oh, what happened to the guy that shot him?
I don't know which one it was. It was either Mike or one of the boys. They felt bad about it, but everything turned out fine.
Oh, no, it was one of his own men that shot him.
Yeah, when the boys were with me, I don't know who shot him. It's either Mike shot him or Patrol or one of the boys shot him. But it was just an accident, you know. And then from then on in, you don't come in the back door. I didn't want him to come in the back door.
Oh, I see.
We either all go in the front or you can see somebody.
That's
who the hell do we know? Somebody, he figured he'd cover the house. This is the first house coming into town in this little German village. And Tank probably figured if someone was going out the back, he'd be there. I don't give a damn where they go out the back. I want the house clear. You know, if the German runs to the next house, okay, we'll catch him up at the next house. But I'm looking for him. Get him out. You know, clear the house. That's all we want to do. Clear the house so we can move. Well, Tank was walking around, comes in the back door. He didn't do any more back door. He stayed with us where he belonged. Down that gun. You know, it's funny. They don't worry you. And we come home.
Well, you said that some of the best time you ever had was after the war ended, didn't you? Were...
Oh, I had a lot of fun with the motorcycle. Yeah, and
you were like in charge of supplies?
Oh, no, I belonged to the MPs. The provost marshal. In other words, I checked the railroad cars and they're broken into and to the mail cars. And that's all. And that handout outside of Frankfurt. And I traveled on the train for a while.
What period of time were you in active combat in Germany?
I'd say about 5 or 6 months, that's about it. Yeah. I had enough points at home after the war. And, you know, I remember pulling me out of line and sending me to France for a vacation. I think where the hell I was. Just in the back of my mind, there was a little incident there where I was coming out of the line. What the hell was it? The old man called me out and took me out. Said, you're in the pass to Nice. I go to Nice or Riviera. Went to Nice. 3 day pass to Nice. That's it. No, I didn't either. Yeah, I went to Nice. That's right. Yeah, I got a bath and a whole bit, and all new line of clothes and all that. Everything. Had a nice time there. Didn't see much. Just walked around the streets. Anyhow, somebody wasn't shooting at it. You know. So I went back. And, I mean, it's really tough. You pull you out of the line. You go to a place, have a nice vacation, then you know where you're going back. So the second time the old man pulled me out, he said, Dick, he said, you're going to the Riviera. I said, I'm not going. He said, what do you mean you're going? I mean, it's an order, you know, you've got to go. I said, wait a minute. I said, Captain Maddox, I said, you don't seem to understand. I don't want to come back here. I said, you get me the hell out of here. I don't want to come back. I said, you've already sent me away. I had a 3 day pass to Nice. I said, you know, take the other boy. I don't care who the hell you take. You know, I don't want to come back. If I get out of here, I'll probably go AWOL. I said, after all, you're going to handle so much of this. Okay, if you want to stay here, you stay. You know, back to the war, and then I got to pass to go to Riviera. I'm down there about 5 or 6 days. I don't know, pull me out again. He respected my wishes. He's pretty decent, you know. In fact, I was talking to him in California. Brooks called me and he said he was sitting there with Captain Maddox, you know, just about 3 years ago. And I was talking, said hello, and we shipped the bowl a little bit, you know. I think 2 months after I was talking to him, died of a heart attack. So I did get to speak to him a couple years ago. You know.
Who was the lieutenant you said you went to see in Washington?
Cavanaugh. Lieutenant Cavanaugh. Andrew Jackson Cavanaugh III.
Sure.
Andrew Jackson Cavanaugh III. His father was a diplomat in Washington, D.C. And they're from the old family, you know, the real Virginia family, you know. Really, history goes back a ways from them. Couldn't ask for it. Marvelous, so very nice guy. He was great. He was just a nice lieutenant. Oh, I meant to tell you. He came back. I think we're on our way to Speer. Lieutenant Speer, Thomas Speer, Germany. Andy's back, and we come back, the boys all got some cognac and some booze. We're going to have a party. So they're in this one house, and they're drinking, and they're having a good time, you know. Andy's tickled pink. He's back with his boys, you know. 2 days later, They ship him out again. He had a blood clot in his leg.
Wow.
Found a blood clot. Back he went. He was broken hearted. We didn't see him after that. That's the end of it. Then sort of warp him after he hit Spear. And a couple other times the war sort of come to an end. We went to the Al Saint Mountains. We're up in the mountains where it ended. Digging foxhole in the glacier. Oh, Christ. It's all over with. I remember sitting in this house looking out over that field. There's a house way out there. Way out in that field. And the war was still on, but Roosevelt had died. I said, okay. So anyhow, we figured the war would be over any day. Who the hell wants to get shot now? It's over with. I mean, we're done. It's whining right on down. Everything's fine. Somehow or another, it ain't over yet until it's over, you know what I'm saying. I think I'm trying to get it straight in my mind. It's 3 or 4 at night, we're sent out for an observation post out to this house. The next day, I don't know how the hell it is, they show it live in hell out of the house and kill all the 2 GIs that were in it. The war ended that day.
Who shelled the house?
The Germans. You know, they had something over the Steinwood woods there, and they did, that was it. Fired there, and they hadn't been told it was over yet. You know, we got sort of a touchy situation in the war. Absolutely, we knew it was over. It was done. They were signed and done. But you get some outside pockets, and maybe
sure.
The German communication wasn't too good. Hey, they're still going at it. They have no idea. Boy, you walked on eggs. You stopped right there. We didn't move anything. I remember sitting on the back of this house on the porch, and this German walked around, two of these German walked right around the house and got their hands and surrendered. I never knew where the hell they came from. It was all over with. It was all done. You know, Christmas a little bit. The hell do I want? You know, Rouse and the children come on down the street, empty down there. The way they went. Boy, I got my ass in the house. That's just when I shot Tara Franca.
Did you say you actually disabled a tank once or something?
Yeah, the tanker. Yeah. The only tank I got was that one that was in the graveyard. But Scott got the ones that where I sent him out to get. See, the bazooka didn't fire the first time. He came back and loaded and sent him out again. He was my bazooka man. He might have been good. He's going to work. So he got it. They brought another tank up, hooked onto it, and pulled it out. But it didn't burn it. That was at the woods, the mill, at the Libreo Mill. There's a courtyard out there. The tank had pulled right toward the edge of the door by the courtyard. I could see it in the middle of the night. But the old tank, Brooks or Scott, go get that tank, hit it, see if you can get it. I mean, you only 10 feet from that damn tank. It was pitch dark, you know. But when we stopped and I hear that damn thing go click, it didn't go off. So the bazookas were Mickey Mouse. All they were was a stovepipe that would let the rocket fly out once you energize it, you know. So we brought him in, we lowered it again. We didn't have the fire on, right? The tap on the shoulder and he took it off. That's how the bitch went off. And then the thing exploded, blew his helmet off. And while he was in the yard, I get the mortar shell.
No, who's held off?
Scott. And I get the mortar shell in the yard at the same time. There was a motorcycle in the middle. I was trying to start it. And I don't know which lieutenant came up. Chewed my ass off for 10 minutes. Because he thought it was a booby trap. I got that son of a bitch running, I'd been riding around. I'm kicking it over, you know, and he's hollering at me.
Was it BMW?
No. I think it was an old NSU or something like that. You know, single cylinder. I would start, I'd probably roll it down the road. What the hell do you think you're doing? Because get off that move, that could be booby trapped, and he was right. He could have been, you know. Too damn late now, I kicked it probably 15 times trying to get the damn thing going. If I had a motorcycle tied on the back of the half track, the old man made me throw it away. Where the hell are you going with that? Well, I found it, throw it off. Pretty fair.
So you got back from the Army then, and what did you see? You became a lineman?
Yeah, I worked for Michael McCoy. Sardoni, worked with Sardoni first.
Before that, you were telling me a story yesterday about, I think you were a kid and you were watching, you went to get a sandwich from Dad or something, and they were doing some stringing or something.
Well, they were repairing the nets when Edward drove, we drove his tricycle across the bay.
Right.
Then he fell through the ice. Then we dragged him out of there, and then Dad made him run all the way home so he wouldn't freeze to death, and we rode the Model T up over the hill. Put him down a little bit, but he's right with him. You know, he's right behind pushing. It's a miracle he didn't put him on. No, it's a playground. Lake Erie, that's all we know. We're always down there. Fish house, the sand dock. That's where we learned to swim. Jack took us down the sand dock one day and threw us in. What he meant, you know, he was right there, ain't he? I remember picking up Edward and throwing him head first right in the bay. It was about 6 feet from the dock down to the water. So he liked it. He's swimming around in there. And then they threw me in right afterward. You gotta learn to swim too. Boom. In we went.
And you were saying about some guy that got caught in a wire and you saw his leg get
away. Oh, yeah. Tore his leg right off.
How'd that happen?
They were launching the boat. They had the cable tied off so the boat would go down. When it come tight, it just threw him off in the air and was rattled and didn't realize it.
Well. Hello, Debbie. I'm gonna hang up. Tell that whole story while I hit the jump, Dad.
What?
Oh, about how you came to be out there when the guy, you saw the guy flying in the air.
Oh. Did I ever tell you a story how I first met my son-in-law? Colin said he was coming up for a visit. I'll tell you, when I opened that door, and at the shock of my life, there he was, all 135 pounds in there. Bushy eyed, bushy haired. Looking for Dolly. And it turned out pretty good anyhow. I gave Colleen all those papers of mine. She's gone from shooting that tanker and that stuff. She's got them all. I gave her a set, Colleen, a deputy set, and Dickie kept with my discharge papers just in case they were there. They'd have a set of them. There's the story of my life.
What was your first motorcycle shop?
Little Sights.
That was the first one?
That's the only one.
How'd you come to start it?
I don't know.
Part-time?
No, not really. Yeah, I guess so. I was up in Latonia, New Hampshire, road racing. Stripe asked me to be a dealer. I got a line to be a dealer. I can't afford to go a second. Said, well, you only have to buy one. I said, well, I can't afford one. Hey, you've got a shop. So Mother lent me the money to build a motorcycle shop, the first one.
Who did?
My mother. $2,000 I built the shop.
On Villa Sites?
Yeah. The first part there. Okay. Where the showroom is. That's the first shop. Then the add on at the back and then this other garage is the third section of it.
Okay.
Well, yeah, I got that done. Well, once the roadman came up, Jack Mercer. What the hell did he do? First two customers were two girls. They bought two Triumph Cups.
Right.
First two motorcycles I ever sold, two little Triumph Cubs. Yeah. Well, Mercer dropped the motorcycle off, says, you don't have to pay for it till you sell it. Well, he's a shifty son of a gun anyhow, you know. I get a letter from Triumph, they want $600 some dollars for that motorcycle. I called Triumph up, I said, what do you mean you want $600 for a motorcycle, and I didn't buy none. I said, Jack Mercer dropped it off and said, when we sell it, we can pay for it. Mr. McCormick says, we don't have that agreement with anybody. When you buy a motorcycle, it's paid for. When you sell it, it's your money, you know. So anyhow, I ended up going down to Triumph School. Dick Dorsey was with me then, too. So we then saw Mr. McCormick, the album, his fellow. He's president of Triumph Corporation. I said, Jack Mercer was in my place, in my house, in my kitchen, telling me that he dropped his motorcycle. It was a 500 Triumph. Carl Shields bought it. He said, I didn't have to pay for it until it was sold. I told him I didn't have any money for that Triumph. He said, Dick, we don't have an agreement with anybody. So he called Jack Mercer and chewed his ass up. Then he really gave him a hell of a time, you know. So he asked me, he said, when could you pay for it? So I think Carl was down there with me. Carl said, he'll buy it. I said, okay. My brother-in-law will buy it. You know, trying to think. I think it was $500-some. I was thinking, somewhere in there, you know. Carl bought the machine, used it for a drag racing, and wrote it for a mile. Still got it. Sitting up in his garage.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, we sent the motor to the Triumph, had it rebuilt, made a racing engine out of it, put mag and everything on it, and used the drag races. It wouldn't run. Turn almost 10 grand.
What year was it?
60. Had to be one of the first ones there.
Yeah. What did you say? You were one of the earliest Triumph dealers in the country?
Pretty close. There wasn't too many around selling tires. There's probably the last one in the country. There wasn't hardly anybody left selling when I knew. Just nobody.
So you were one of the first and the last?
Yeah, that's just about it. Just about it.
So after you sold it to Carl, then what'd you do?
Oh, I don't know. I just went to the shop, had a few things here and there. And, you know, got a table.
I mean, company. How'd you get another one?
Well, I went to the bank and got a floor plan. Mr. Rusheko gave me $2,500. So I bought a couple of Triumphs. I sold the first one to Chuck Landers and sold the next one I sold to...
Chuck Landers. He's from
here. Jim Nelson. Friend of mine. He bought one, he bought a 650 Triumph, Tanger TR6. No, Chuck bought the TC, TRC, and...
Were you making money on these sales, or you just turned it over?
No, I made a few bucks, not too much. I think the money I made at the Cyber Series, if I hadn't been for that, I would never have kept going.
What about the Cyber Series?
If I had the money I made at the Cyber Series, I'll pay for the full section spot until you got her going. Then it got started to take off pretty good. Triumph had a real nice reputation, you know. Damn good reputation.
You gotta get me another tape.
You got
I'm done for now. Relax.
It's what's it doing now?
Rewinding.
It's rewinding?
Yeah.
Where? In there?
This one, yeah.
Oh, that one. What's that one? That one's just still playing.
Yeah. What's this? What that?
You can get mother up here and everything keep talking.
Mom?